Well, Comrade Chair and comrades, we've explored this theme that we will be discussing today on at least two or three occasions when socialism has taken place. And despite the fact that we're in now the fourth or fifth year of a devastating world economic crisis, you have to say that in society in general, pro-capitalist ideas are still predominant. All the main parties in Britain, and most of those internationally, seek a solution to this crisis within the framework of capitalism. Miliband, for instance, the leader of New Labour, if you examine his programme, all that it amounts to is that when he'll come to power, he'll change the curtains at number 10 Downing Street. That's the reality on the programme that he is putting forward for the working class. At the Labour Party conference, he came out in an extremely vacuous speech for the idea of one nation, when it's obviously clear, and that was borrowed from Disraeli, but Disraeli didn't just leave it there. He spoke about two nations in Britain, and in Britain today, you see that the two nations confront each other over a social abyss, and moreover, an abyss that is becoming wider by the day, by the month, and by the year. Even Francis Fukuyama, remember him? At the time of the collapse of the Berlin Wall, he prognosticated that the class struggle was over. We were at the end of history, and he meant by that, well, now we have liberal capitalist democracy, which is the only viable solution for the problems of humankind. All other experiments, social experiments, has failed. Even he has come out, changed his position, and in a critique of capitalism, has said we have to seek for an alternative. Even a left alternative, Fukuyama says. But if you examine what he actually is proposing, all of his ideas, like the majority of capitalist ideologues, seek a solution within the framework of capitalism itself. And yet, if you examine what is happening internationally, this is a most profound crisis. It's the worst crisis for about 86 years. If you examine what the spokesmen of the ruling class themselves say, the IMF says, well, the world economy is on the ropes. A Hong Kong capitalist said he's never been more scared in his life about the social consequences of what is happening to capitalism at this moment in time. And of course, we have the examples of Greece, of Spain, of Portugal, that we'll go into perhaps at the rally this evening as a visible and practical demonstration of the incapacity of capitalism to deliver the goods. On top of that, now we see the rapid change that has taken place in France since the election of Hollande, where now the social problems have accumulated and Hollande is now the most unpopular president within 6 months of coming to power in the whole period of the Fifth Republic itself. I myself went on a visit to social democratic Scandinavia recently. I visited Sweden, which in the past was used as a model for the ruling class in Britain and particularly for the right wing within the Labour Party itself. And while I was there, I was acquainted with the reality of the position that exists in Sweden. There's 28% youth unemployment in Sweden. At one stage, when I was there over the weekend, it was purely an accident. I had very little to do with it. An actual riot took place, and I had my photograph taken against a burned-out car in a council estate, comrades put underneath, Peter Taft comes to Sweden and starts a riot. It is symptomatic of the position that is developing at the moment. The social democracy in Denmark is at its lowest point for 100 years. That is the reality. Even Germany is grinding to a halt with a 0.9% increase in the economy this year. And by the way, most of the economists of capitalism The serious economists of capitalism think that you need at least a 3% growth in the economy, and not in 1 year, but a compound rate over a period of time in order to establish, if you like, a stable situation as far as capitalist society is concerned, and particularly to begin to eradicate the scourge of mass unemployment. This crisis is not just in Europe. China now is slowing down. It's being compared by the Financial Times to a car that's stuck in the snow. The wheels churn, but the economy does not go forward. And China was held out as a hope for world capitalism in the past. The US, as we know, faces what they call a fiscal cliff of the enormous growth of the debt, which will confront any government, despite who wins the election next Tuesday itself. And one thing is absolutely clear. 90% of the population of America, of families, will pay for the debt in one form or another. That will stand at 250% of the GDP of the US, unless the government does something about it. The same exists in Japan, where the accumulated debts of the state now stand at 230%. And on the other hand, the hope that was put forward that the countries of the neo-colonial world, in the so-called BRICS in Brazil, in Russia and so on, they would at least offer the chance of a locomotive for the development of the world economy. That now has gone down the pan. The Putin regime in Russia is reliant on oil to an extent that you've not seen in history for that regime. And Putin has moved further and further towards the right. And we see now he's more reliant on the Orthodox Church and on the Cossacks to quell the inevitable revolt that's coming in Russia in the period that we're going into. If you take Europe, and particularly Southern Europe, we have articles now in the Financial Times from a well-known commentator like Gillian Tett, who says that whole countries have been humiliated by what's being demanded of them. And the process of humiliation is, number one, loss of control. Number two, demotion of the status of the country itself. Number three, partial or complete exclusion from the group. And that breeds massive national resentment of the institutions of the EU, and particularly of those countries who are seen to be grinding their heel into the necks, if you like, of the Spanish, of the Greek people. So much so that during the European Football Championship, when the Irish fans travelled to the Ukraine, they carried a huge banner that was photographed at the airport. They were travelling during the week, and the banner read, "Angela Merkel thinks we're working." That is a national resentment against the demands that are being put forward by Germany or by German imperialism at the present time. And therefore, there is a devastating crisis of world capitalism. But that does not automatically mean that the consciousness of the broad mass of the working class actually understands and sees that. In general, human consciousness, human understanding is extremely conservative. It lags behind the objective march of events. The working class, faced with an avalanche of mass redundancies, of enormous burdens being imposed on their shoulders, actually are hoping against hope that the crisis will be over soon and we can return back to the pre-2007-2008 situation. That wasn't very good, by the way. There was an underlying crisis then. But that is probably the consciousness of the broad mass of the working class. There is no final crisis of capitalism, a point that Lenin emphasized. Capitalism will always find a way out of the crisis, but it's not just a question of saying that. They'll find a way out on the basis of the destruction of the rights and a massive attack on the living standards of the working class. Only then will they find a relative stability for the system itself. And that is particularly the case at the present time in this phase of the crisis. And moreover, the working class will pay, and society will pay, if a way out is not found. We have the horror of the rise of Golden Dawn in Greece. That's like, if you like, a shadow, to use a biblical phrase, a shadow no bigger than the size of a man's fist, which is on the horizon. At the moment, they will not be able to take power. But already the Greek workers are afraid of the return of the tanks. I don't think that that is likely in the immediate period. But we remember the position pre-1967, a period very similar today, of enormous turmoil, when not a left government, but a centre union liberal government was in power, of the great-grandfather of the leader of PASOK, Andreas Papandreou, it was George Papandreou, and the colonels decided to take power with, of course, the support of the CIA and American imperialism itself. But Golden Dawn must be counted. There were many people who said, ignore it, it will go away. And after all, only 3 years ago, Golden Dawn was no more than 0.7% of the vote in the Greek elections. Now, according to the latest opinion poll, it's standing at 14%. We need a program to combat it. Our comrades in Sikinimer in Greece are to the fore in putting forward a concrete program of propaganda, of agitation, but also the physical means of defending the workers' organizations in this battle that is taking place. Even if capitalism does not recover, it won't appear as such for the mass of the working class. Even if it does recover, rather, it won't appear, if you look at it from every point of view, like that for the mass of the working class. There's now no normal period of capitalism as we understood it in the past. The period of 1950 to 1975 was an exception of a long boom, of a visible increasing living standards that is gone. We're in a period now of short-term perspectives. Even as the booms take place, they will be shallow. They won't be able to restore the position that existed before. There's a consensus amongst capitalist economists. People like Cameron, Martin Wolf, King in the Financial Times and so on. And they say, well, the best scenario we can have now for Britain is a lost decade. Some go further and say, it won't be one lost decade, it'll be two or three lost decades on the basis of a continuation of this system itself. They use a phrase now of contained depression. What that means is because of the measures they've taken, they've temporarily prevented a 1930s type situation developing, which was a sharp drop in production and a sharp drop in the living standards of working people. Now, they haven't got the same degree of a crisis of the 1930s, but we have the existence of mass unemployment and a deterioration for millions of workers in their living standards as well. There is no silver lining for this crisis. Now, the question that is posed in the title of this meeting today, what was the cause of this crisis? To some extent, we explored this in the discussion that we had last year, but it's necessary to go over it. And the first point to make is there's no monocausal explanation for the crisis of capitalism. It's a sea system that's based upon the production for profit, not on social need. Profit comes from the unpaid labour of the working class. That surplus value that Trotsky spoke about said, he who controls surplus value produced by the labour of the working class, controls science, controls society, controls culture, and so on. The class struggle, reduced to its simplest, is the struggle over the surplus. Who will control the surplus? Marx also pointed in Capital about another trend within capitalism, and that is the tendency of the rate of profit to decline. That is because dead labour grows at a greater proportion of living labour, which is the labour power of the working class, if you like. And therefore, there is an historical tendency for the rate of profit to decline. There are counteracting factors to that which Marx goes into. I can't go into it in the discussion at the present time. Now, this is not one explanation of this crisis. It is part of the explanation of what is happening at the present time. We notice, for instance, The profits have declined. As a rate, if you like, the rate of profit has declined for capitalism in general. The statistics have been produced in other situations. I don't have time to go into that in this opening, but if it comes up in discussion, I'll come back to it. Other factors are like the lack of demand. What the capitalists talk about, the lack of demand. And basically, capitalism would be in permanent crisis because the working class can never buy back the goods that they produce because they don't get the full value of their product. That's concentrated in profit in the surplus. Capitalism goes on, however, by the investment of that surplus back into production, and therefore the spiral of capitalism continues. But they reach a stage where the same problems are reproduced and they cannot buy back the full product of their labour. That is manifested in a glut. Today, if you like, an excess capacity of capitalism, which is lying idle and cannot be used profitably. There is other factors. Faced with this situation, if you like, 20 years ago, capitalism resorted to a massive injection of fictitious capital into the economy. That made sure that capitalism, by providing an artificial market in a sense, allowed capitalism to go ahead. They've now reached the limits of that. And these huge debt overhang of companies, of the state, of individuals has produced a deadlock which is manifested in what the capitalist economists themselves call deficiency of demand. The idea is absolutely absurd. If you think about it, there's massive demand worldwide for all kinds of goods, but there's a deficiency of demand in relation to the capitalist system itself. Look at what is happening in the banks at the present time. We've given these figures before, but it's worthwhile thinking about it and what the implications are for capitalist society and how we deal with that in our propaganda and our agitation. The Observer, a month or so ago, carried a front-page article. It was astonishing. No party took it up. No spokesman took it up, apart from the supporters of the Socialist Party. And in that particular article, they explained that in the banks of the big companies, or in the vaults of the big companies, of the banks, of the monopolies and so on, there is a total of $21 trillion. That is twice, that is the equal to the GDP of the US and of Europe put together. That, a colossal amount, if it was used properly, would cancel the debt of all the countries of Europe, including the British debt. In Britain, there is £750 billion in the vaults of the banks. The debt, the so-called state debt, is minuscule in comparison to that. Immediately, they could cancel the debt by introducing, let's say, a 50% tax on the profits of the capitalists who are not able to use it. The fact that the ruling class, that capitalism has dislodged, Marx once described the capitalists as misers, as rational misers, of accumulating the hoard. But they accumulate in order to invest, in order to drive the system forward. I was in a debate at the Oxford Union. I might mention it tonight in the rally. And one of the points we made against the spokesman of capitalism is your system is defunct, or even according to your own criteria. Because the only justification for capitalism is that it will, despite the horrors of the slave trade, despite the unemployment, despite the alienation, the environmental destruction, the only justification for capitalism is the surplus is invested back into the means of production. That is the organization of labor, science, and technique. You are not carrying out this function today. You are betraying your mission, as Marx put it, the trustees of society, of taking forward the productive forces. You were a relatively progressive force in the past. Now you're becoming an absolute barrier to the further development of capitalist society. As you will imagine, they didn't agree with me on that point, but we won the debate anyway, because the majority of the students supported our position itself. What are the consequences of this? A paralysis of capitalism, of zombie banks, of zombie companies, and of course, the system as a whole. The bourgeois are in panic. Even Tories suggested recently that the partially nationalised banking system of RBS and so on, that should be made into a nationalised bank and be used to invest in the economy. Who objected to that? None other than Alistair Darling and the right wing in the Labour Party. Because they are really a bourgeois force now. As Tony Blair said when he was in power, you can call it what you like, we'll give whatever assistance is necessary, but don't call it nationalisation. And why wouldn't they propose nationalisation of the banks? Because the appetite increases with eating. If you're going to have the nationalisation of the banks, why not then go on and suggest the nationalisation of failing industries? Like, for instance, the car industry at the present time. They've even come up with the idea, why don't we try Keynesianism on a massive scale? The present head of the Federal Reserve in America, a man called Bernanke, he's known as Helicopter Ben. Because before he was appointed to his position, he wrote a thesis saying that in the event of a crisis, what we should do is we should produce money, go to the printing press, to some extent they've done that, and we should drop it over the most needy sections of society, and then we'll get the scoundrels to go out and buy. That's the theory that he put. The latest theory is that may not work. But one wheeze that Samuel Britton for the Financial Times has come out with is, why don't we have a colossal treasure hunt? Bury millions of pounds below the ground and then give a hint to the poorest section of society. Don't do it in the middle class areas or in the rich areas, because they'll get the loot and they put it back in the bank. So it will defeat the purpose. Go to the poorest section of the population, have an enormous treasure hunt, and in that way, maybe they'll start spending and the spiral of a growth of the economy will continue. That's, if you like, an indication of the dilemma that capitalism is in at this particular stage. It's gradually dawned on the ruling class that this will be a long, drawn-out process. There's been some interesting articles in the Financial Times in the last couple of weeks, one of which showed that capitalism can no longer harness the technique and the new inventions that are coming on stream. It's lost its inventiveness. And they point to the fact that capitalism had a period from roughly the middle of the 18th century to the middle of the 19th century, if you like, the invention of steam power, railways and so on, in which that played a role in the upward swing of capitalism. And then there was the period from 1850 to roughly the middle of the last century when there was a new technological wave. And they make the interesting point that the so-called third phase of information technology has not played the same role. That capitalism cannot harness the new inventions that are being developed. Just as, for instance, all the things that developed in the aftermath of the Second World War were on hand in the 1930s, but capitalism, stuck in that position, could not utilise the potential that existed at that particular stage. We have to be a bit careful about this, because Rosa Luxemburg put forward the position that only the physical expansion of capitalism was able to show a way out for the system. Lenin pointed out capitalism can actually invest internally, if you like, in new investments. And depending that the market is there, there can be a certain growth. But one thing is clear, that any development of capitalism will be a very shaky position. It will be small booms, if you could call it that, if you like, truncated by even a more deepening crisis for the capitalist system itself. And that poses the question, well, we know what capitalism is and we understand the workings of the system. We have a better understanding, frankly, than the spokesman of capitalism itself. We're always careful to weigh up all the possibilities within the system. But then the question is socialism viable? You would not expect me to answer this in anything but the affirmative. But our support for socialism is not one of blind faith. If we accept that capitalism will not be able to deliver the goods, will not be able to supply adequate goods and services to humankind and free them from hunger or environmental catastrophe, we have to look for a new system. Marx's historical schema was based upon this. He said, well, slavery was really where the slaves were used as tools of production itself. Feudalism was individual production and individual appropriation of the surplus created by the serf. Capitalism was social production, where the working class produces in large factories and from a social point of view, but the individual appropriation of the surplus that they create by the capitalists themselves who invest back into production, as I have explained. Socialism will be social production and social appropriation. But what is the regime between capitalism and socialism? It can only be a transitional regime of a worker state, of course, of a democratic worker state that would lead to socialism. Socialism implies a higher level of productivity, a higher level of standard of living than the most advanced levels of capitalism that's been reached. In other words, higher than the highest level reached in the USA today. And moreover, not in one country, but if you like, from a world point of view. In 1917, when the Russian working class took power, it was in a backward country. The Bolsheviks didn't say, we can start socialism here. They said, no, capitalism is breaking at its weakest link. We can begin a process that can spread the revolution internationally, especially to Germany, which would supply the technologists, the engineers, the scientists to the Russian, to Russia, which of course has got a surplus in food and so on. And then it would spread to the world. And if anybody wants to know the effect of the Russian Revolution, read John Dos Passos' book, 1919, of the effect that it had in America itself. And in that schema was that the Russian Revolution was the 10 days that would not only shake the world, but would remake the world, if you like, from a socialist point of view. That didn't happen because of the betrayal of the social democracy. I'll correct that by saying it did happen. The working class tried to take power, but they were betrayed by the socialist democracy, by the social democracy itself. And of course, Russia, it was the poverty of resources, of the cultural level, the isolation of the Russian Revolution, and of course, the betrayal of the social democrats, which led to them stagnating, and of course, then on the basis of backwardness, the rise of a privileged bureaucratic layer in the form of Stalinism itself. We face an entirely new situation there today. Firstly, unlike in the past, and this is a very important point for us to grasp, capitalism has developed the productive forces for the first time in history, which allows us to abolish want and privation from the whole of the planet. In 1917, a minority of the populations of the world lived in cities, not just in Russia, but throughout the world. Now, over 50% of the world's population is in urban areas. We can give many examples of the wastage under capitalism. For instance, of advertising, totally unnecessary advertising. How many of you, if you have BT Vision, you record a program and then you play it yourself so you can cut out all the adverts? Even in China, there's a revolt against adverts at the present time. There's arms production. The US spends $1 trillion on defense. Against what? Against Al-Qaeda? $1 trillion in defense of the US? There is unused capacity, which capitalism cannot use because it does not pay them. Then there's the wastage of mass unemployment. There is arms production and so on, which we could use in the transitional period to transform it from arms production, if you like, to useful production. Take the Ford's workers in Southampton today. 1,400 workers going down the road. The 4,000 who'll be made unemployed in Genk. And they'll be staging a demonstration, I believe, in conjunction with the workers in Southampton. If there's not a market for cars, and many of the car workers, by the way, when this crisis began, they had an understanding of this. Why not propose, could be done very simply, of transforming a production from cars to production for useful goods, for instance, for the neo-colonial world, which is crying out for the goods that exist in the advanced industrial countries themselves. A few years ago, Lucas Aerospace, who faced redundancies, came up with a scheme for transforming from arms production for useful production, which is a very interesting and important example of the marvelous inventiveness of working class people when they put their mind to it. Capitalism is a chaotic, unplanned society. We stand for a harmonious planning of the resources of all of society. Then there's the question of how we feed the world. 1 billion people are going hungry at the present time. The latest figures on food production show that perhaps the biggest social question that we'll face in the next year will be famine and will be starvation throughout the planet. 2 billion people are on less than $2 a day. Yet we have the predictions of a Russian scientist, Mendeleev, in the 19th century, who showed the possibilities that existed if science and technique were harnessed to the benefit of the population as a whole. And by the way, Mendeleev also put forward the idea that the planet could easily handle 10, maybe up to 15 billion people. I think it's 6 to 7 billion is the target at the present time. How many people know, it might be very crushed, but if the whole of the population was concentrated in France at the same density of Paris, the whole of the population would get into the environs of France. It wouldn't be very comfortable, wouldn't be many green trees, but it just shows you that only part of this planet is lived on at the present time, and the possibilities exist, of course, under a planned economy to deal with that situation. Not that it would necessarily get to that particular stage. There's inequality, and it's growing. During this crisis, it's got a lot worse. In Russia, 7 oligarchs control 50% of the Russian economy. 7 men control the destiny. I think it's of about 180 or 200 million people at the present time. 300 families control 40% of the world's wealth. That was in 1996. It's immeasurably worse at the present time. This raises the question, if you have a planned economy, how are you going to manage production in society? The first step we would do is to cut the working week. What a paradox. We have comrades in this room who made redundancy with colossal talents in computers and so on. And yet, what does the IMF and the powers that be propose to the Greek people? They work an extra day. They work 6 days a week. Well, millions of people are unemployed. No suggestion of sharing out the work without loss in pay. Even Keynes, a capitalist economist, in the last century, said by today, by the beginning of this century, humankind could be working a 15-hour day. Look at the situation in housing at the present time. In 1968, there was 425,000 houses built, of which 184,000 were council houses. In 2010, 134,000 houses were built in Britain, of which there was 1,320. Now that, in Liverpool, during the reign of Tony Mulhern, Paddy Smith, and our councillors in Liverpool, we built in the course, over a period of time, literally 5 times the amount of houses that the whole of the British economy is built in 2010. That was a living example of what planning and what the movement of the working class can actually establish. Then the argument could be, what guarantee is there that Stalinism will not rise again? There's no guarantee that Stalinism will rise. I have to be frank with you in relation to this. Even today, in the advanced industrial countries, in the trade unions, there's a trend towards bureaucratism within the trade union movement itself. We all confront that, whether it's in Britain, whether it's in Belgium, and so on and so forth. But at the same time, we have a very highly educated working class. We have a cultural level that could not be imagined in 1917, when the working class did take power. If you take that as a starting point, and you do what Lenin advocated, to immediately cut the working week. Not so you just have more pleasure necessarily, although that would come. But in order to give time, the most precious commodity of all, for working people to manage and organize the control of industry and of society. If you're working all the hours that God sends, I use that metaphorically, not being religious myself, but if you're working a colossal amount of hours, Like, for instance, teachers today. I have a daughter who's a teacher. She does not have time to think. She works from morning to night. Every spare time, that every spare moment she has is devoted towards studying in order to go back into the classroom. They don't even have time to prepare for their lessons. Multiply that in every sphere of British society, of British industry at the present time, and you'll see that time is the most precious commodity of all. Why not cut the working day? Lenin said, when it looked as though the German workers were taking power in 1918, he said, the first thing you have to do is cut the working day to give time for you to organize and manage society as a whole. And then, of course, you'll be able to check and control at every stage. How would we organize debates and discussions within society? This raises the question of the media. We don't want to take over, especially in the light of the scandal that we've had in relation to the Murdoch Empire. We don't want to take over the Sun and the other organs of News International, of Murdoch. We don't want to produce another Sun. He can have the Sun. Murdoch can have the Sun. So long as we control the means of information, and not just for ourselves, but in order to give the full expression to the range of views that exist within society, to nationalise the media resources, all aspects of the media, and then, of course, on the basis of your votes in elections, you would have a certain proportion of the right to put your point of view. But minorities have rights as well. They would be given access. In the phone hacking scandal, and now in the Savile scandal, we see the way that the BBC is being used, or there's attacks being used on the BBC, and we have no brief for the BBC per se, but in general, a state-controlled enterprise is preferable to a private enterprise because, in theory anyway, there's the possibility of the labour movement exercising influence over it. And we would, on that basis, you could have a nationalised industry. The socialists would be the size of the Sun, and the Sun would be the size of the socialists today. And we don't mind if, I've made this joke before, but perhaps some of you haven't heard it. We don't mind if Rupert Murdoch then stands outside Euston Station with his copy of the Sun, which would be the size of the socialists, saying, go back to capitalism, mass unemployment, and all the miseries and so on. We don't mind him doing that. And of course, we would have the circulation and the power of the Sun at the present time. In a socialist society, it won't just be democracy. Science, culture would flourish. It would generate tremendous enthusiasm amongst the masses. It's unlikely that we would become like the lotus eaters in ancient Greek mythology. If any of you understand the ancient or know about ancient Greek mythology, the lotus eaters, when Odysseus arrived at an island and they ate the lotus fruit, they all became lazy and lay around and they wouldn't go back on the boat and go back to Greece. But we wouldn't become like that, I don't think. What happens to the bourgeois today who have nothing to do? They spend time on art and on culture. That's the intelligent ones. The rest play golf or something else. And therefore, it would be the same, if you like, under a socialist planned economy. Comrades, we don't have a blueprint of the future society. It will be up to the initiative, the energy and the drive, if you like, of working people, and particularly of the new generation. But nevertheless, we can say one thing. This society is failing. The working class will rise up. We have the living example of what's happening in Europe today, of what's happening in South Africa. The working class will rise up. What demands are you going to make? There's not a syllable of socialism passes the lips of Miliband. The trade union leaders don't come out with it now. We must conduct the campaign in all corners of the labour movement and go beyond that. Amongst working people, propagating once more the ideas of socialism, the ideas of a transformation of society. They thought they discredited and buried socialism with the collapse of the Berlin Wall. What was buried there was not socialism, was not democratic socialism, but was the perversion of socialism with Stalinism. This generation will rediscover the ideas that I've been trying to put forward today, the ideas of socialism, and in that way, we can rebuild the movement. We can rebuild a powerful socialist party, but over and above that, a mass organisation that this time, in the 21st century, will lead the working class to power and establish, in your lifetime, a democratic socialist society in Britain and throughout the world. Thank you.